Welcome to our webinar titled Understanding Bone Marrow Failure Syndromes. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Lee Clark, patient educator, and I'll be moderating the presentation today. As we get started, I'd like to recognize the generous support of our pharmaceutical partners and the generous support of our patients, families, and caregivers for supporting the webinar program today. Due to the high volume of teleconferences on the internet, it is possible you may lose your connection during the program. If you are unable to view the program online, you can call in to hear the audio portion by using the call-in number in your reminder email. Today's program will be archived to our website within 2 to 3 business days. You will be notified by email when it is live and ready for viewing. Immediately following the presentation, there will be a question and answer session. Please feel free to submit your questions at any time during the presentation. To submit a question or comment, open the Q&A window in the lower part of your screen. Type your question in the small text box window, and when you have finished typing, just hit enter. We will do our best to get to all questions today. When asking questions, I do ask that you do 2 things to help me manage the incoming questions. First, submit your entire question all at the same time. Second, please do not share private health information in your question. Our expert cannot answer any specific questions related to your health care. Today's specialist is Dr. James Cook, who is a professor of pathology at the Cleveland Clinic Lerner College of Medicine. He serves as the section head of hematopathology in the Department of Laboratory Medicine. Dr. Cook's clinical interests focus on diagnostic hematopathology and molecular diagnostics. With that said, it is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Cook today.
All right, thank you very much. So I'd like to thank all of the organizers for the chance to come and speak with you today. And thank you everyone for attending. So today we're gonna talk about some of the biology and pathology of the bone marrow failure syndromes. So we can define the bone marrow failure syndromes as a group of diseases that are all characterized by low counts in the peripheral blood due to decreased production of blood cells in the bone marrow. And we can divide up this fairly large group of disorders a couple different ways. Some of these disorders are inherited, others are acquired over the course of your life. We can also divide these up depending on the types of cells that are involved. And so some we refer to as being unilineage disorders, where just one cell type is affected, either red blood cells, white blood cells, or platelets. Or in other conditions, all of these are involved producing pancytopenia. So the diagnosis of the bone marrow failure syndromes is fairly complex. So I'm a hematopathologist, and I spend the largest piece of my day every day sitting at a microscope and looking at bone marrow biopsies, peripheral blood smears, and lymph node biopsies. And what we see under the microscope is an important part of the way these disorders are diagnosed, but it's really only one piece. We have to put all of that information together with what our colleagues in clinical hematology find when they do a physical examination, when they take a careful history. And then we have to look at other types of laboratory testing as well. There are some blood tests that are done routinely in this workup. And then increasingly, there's important utilization of DNA-based testing, especially when we're looking for possible hereditary conditions. So we'll talk about a number of these disorders today. This shows you the list of some of the acquired bone marrow failure syndromes. These are the most common of them. The ones that are most common are on the left, two disorders that typically lead to pancytopenia. So low counts of all cell types. And the two most common there are aplastic anemia and paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, or PNH. Then we have the unilineage disorders that affect just one cell type. And these are called pure red cell aplasia, agranulocytosis, and then a very long name, amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia purpura. And we'll talk a little bit about each of these. Then there's an even longer list of disorders that are inherited. And again, some of these produce pancytopenias. Other ones affect only one cell type in the blood. And we're going to talk about just one of these because there's not time to get into many of them. But we'll talk about Fanconi anemia, which is one of the better understood hereditary disorders and serves as a nice example of how we understand inherited bone marrow failure syndromes. Okay, so we'll get started first by talking about aplastic anemia. This is the most common of all of these disorders we'll go over today, but it's still a rare diagnosis. There are 1 to 2 new cases diagnosed every year per million population overall. When we look in the U.S., there really is not significant gender or racial differences within Western countries, but as you look around the world, we do see geographic variation. So this is a much more common diagnosis in Asia than it is in the Western Hemisphere. Finding more than one patient in a family with this diagnosis would be very unusual. In fact, if we take a history and we find more than one patient has been diagnosed with aplastic anemia, that's a clue to us that maybe it's not really aplastic anemia and might be one of these inherited disorders. And patients can come to medical attention a couple different ways. This relates to exactly how low the blood counts are and which cell line is affected the most. So some patients will present with bleeding due to low platelet counts. You can have fatigue or other nonspecific symptoms due to anemia, low red blood cells. And interestingly, although the white cells are often low, it's pretty uncommon for someone to initially present due to infections. This graph shows you the age at which patients are diagnosed. And I think you can see two things here. One is that there's an enormous range. We see young children diagnosed with aplastic anemia. We see elderly patients with the diagnosis. The second thing to notice is there's sort of two distinct peaks in this. Actually, the bulk of patients are diagnosed relatively young, around ages 15 to 25. But then there's a second peak that happens to patients out in their 60s. And these two different peaks create different differential diagnoses, different other considerations that we need to think about when we're first seeing a patient with one of these problems. So aplastic anemia can be further divided up into two different things. Secondary aplastic anemia, or primary or idiopathic aplastic anemia. Secondary aplastic anemia just means that we can find something that seems to have triggered development of this condition. And there's a long list of things that can cause an aplastic anemia. Some of the most common include radiation and drug exposures. So these are often things people have received in treatment for some other condition. We know there are drugs that routinely and predictably can cause an aplastic anemia by decreasing and killing off cells in the bone marrow. For example, many of the chemotherapy drugs that we routinely use, especially those being used to treat leukemia. When you treat leukemia, you're trying to kill off the cells in the bone marrow, and those drugs do that predictably. But then there's a long list of drugs that don't produce an aplastic anemia in most people, but can in a small subset. And this is referred to as a idiosyncratic type of reaction, meaning it's not predictable who's going to develop this. And these do include some relatively commonly used drugs like the nonsteroidal anti-inflammatories. Then there's other viruses. There are other autoimmune conditions that can be associated with this. And even pregnancy can be associated with an increased risk. So when we see a patient coming to the clinic with a diagnosis of aplastic anemia, we have to take a very careful clinical history looking for any of these possible conditions that could have triggered development of this process. Most of the time, though, we can't find any of those. 70 to 80% of the time, you can't find one of those causes. And so we refer to that then as primary or idiopathic aplastic anemia. So there's been a lot of work on understanding the biology of this disease. It's clear that this is a problem of the stem cells in the bone marrow. So the stem cells are the cells that give rise to all of the normal red blood cell, white blood cell precursors in the bone marrow. And in aplastic anemia, there's decreased numbers of stem cells in the bone marrow. And the ones that are there seem to be abnormal as well. If you take them and try to culture them in the laboratory, they don't respond to the usual growth factors the way they should. And in the vast majority of cases, we think this is basically an autoimmune mediated process. Let's talk about what we actually see under the microscope. This is usually where I come in. So when we look at peripheral blood smears, we see low blood counts. The red blood cells that are there usually look normal. Sometimes they're a little larger than normal, so-called macrocytosis. And then the reticulocyte index, which is the proportion of red cells that are newly made, that is often low, indicating that the bone marrow is not producing red cells as it should be. Bone marrow biopsies are done as part of this workup, and we see a loss of cellularity in the bone marrow, so it's hypocellular. We look very carefully through these samples, looking for irregularities in the cell, so what we call dysplastic features or dyspoietic features. These can be changes in the cytoplasm of the cells, changes in the nucleus, that can indicate to us that there's an abnormal maturation happening. When we see these kinds of dysplastic changes in these cells, that worries us that we might actually be dealing with a myelodysplastic syndrome rather than aplastic anemia. That's one of the major differential diagnoses that we have to figure out and establish which is actually the proper diagnosis. So here's an example of what this looks like. This is a bone marrow aspirate smear. And normal bone marrow is a mixture of fat and then all of these dividing precursor cells. And here we have an aspirate smear that has basically nothing but fat left. These are little pieces of tissue that contain fat cells. And then maybe you can see this little network of sort of darkly purple staining material. Those are blood vessels that are left in the fat. And the normal precursor cells are basically all absent. We also look at core biopsies from bone marrow. This helps us really quantify the degree of cellularity in the bone marrow. And so here, the pink areas that you see on the slide, this is part of the bone. And then normally we would expect to see all of these precursor cells mixed in here as well as the fat. But in this particular case, there's really nothing but fat left, essentially an empty appearing bone marrow. And so that's quite typical for first diagnosis of aplastic anemia. Cytogenetic studies are routinely done almost any time a bone marrow biopsy is done when we're worried about bone marrow-based diseases. And in cytogenetic studies, we look at the chromosomes under the microscope, looking for any abnormalities that we can see. In aplastic anemia, cytogenetic studies are usually normal, but we can see some abnormal results in a small subset of cases, somewhere around 10 to 12%. And it's this very unusual finding. It tends to be only a few cells that are abnormal, and that abnormality can actually be transient. So if you do another bone marrow biopsy 3 months, 6 months later, it sometimes goes away. And anytime we see abnormal cytogenetics, that raises a question mark for the pathologist. Are we sure we're dealing with an aplastic anemia, or is there any chance we're dealing with a myelodysplastic syndrome? Or there can even be acute myeloid leukemias that have a very hypocellular looking bone marrow. And so we have to pay very close attention to what we see under the microscope to make these distinctions. Increasingly over the last few years, DNA-based testing has become increasingly important. We use panels of DNA testing to look for mutations that are acquired in the bone marrow cells that might be associated with different hematologic disorders. And in aplastic anemia, with the types of panels we routinely use, we see abnormalities now in about 70 to 80% of cases. If you do very extensive DNA-based testing, which is typically not done in clinical practice yet, almost 100% of cases will show some abnormalities. And we'll show you how we think about those abnormalities now with this cartoon. So over here on the left, this is a diagram that's trying to show bone marrow and bone marrow stem cells. So the stem cells in your bone marrow divide, they give rise to the normal red blood cell and white cell precursors, and they also produce other stem cells. So they're dividing all the time. And every time a cell divides, there's a risk that that division may not be perfect. And during the course of division, mutations can arise. This happens to all of us. We all have a proportion of cells in our bone marrow that carry mutations. And we get more and more as we age, as our cells have divided more. Fortunately, most of those mutations either don't take place inside genes at all, or they're in places within the gene that don't really affect the function. And so most of the time that mutation happens and there's absolutely no clinical consequence. It just gets carried along with the cell and we never know about it. So here on the left, we're trying to show these normal stem cells in light blue. And then sprinkled throughout in these different colors are stem cells that have picked up a mutation. And like we say, all of us are walking around with a few cells carrying different mutations. In aplastic anemia, there's an immune-mediated attack on the stem cells in the bone marrow. And for reasons we don't quite understand, it seems there's often a preferential destruction of the normal stem cells. And so some of these cells that carry mutations might actually be more resistant to that immune-mediated damage. And so you sort of enrich the bone marrow for the cells that carry these mutations. We then treat the aplastic anemia, usually with things like immunosuppressive therapy at first, and then the bone marrow starts to recover. And then that's shown on the right. As these cells recover and divide, you've now enriched for these mutations. And so that's why we detect these much more often in aplastic anemia than we do in normal individuals. So aplastic anemia is normally graded. Severe aplastic anemia has low cellularity in the bone marrow. And then it has low counts of neutrophils, platelets, or reticulocytes that are below the thresholds that are shown here. Moderate aplastic anemia is on the right. These patients have pancytopenia but don't meet these severe criteria. And the response, the natural history of aplastic anemia differs within these two categories. So I've mentioned a little bit about the differential diagnosis that we're thinking about when we work up these cases in the laboratory. So especially when we're looking at bone marrow biopsies from younger patients, we have to worry about some of these inherited pancytopenia syndromes, such as Fanconi's anemia that we'll talk about later, and then some of these other conditions. Many of those hereditary problems can also come to be diagnosed around that 15 to 20 year old age group. Out in that second peak, patients in their 60s and 70s when we see this, then the differential diagnosis tends to be mostly around myelodysplastic syndromes or acute leukemias that sometimes can be very hypocellular also. And so this is where what we see under the microscope again is very important. There are also certain types of lymphomas that are characteristically associated with hypocellular bone marrows. And so we know to look for those in the bone marrow biopsies as well and rule that out. Treatment. So I should first of all say I am a pathologist. I don't treat patients directly. So everything I'm talking about will be sort of the pathologist's interpretation of how the clinical hematologists treat things. But I think everything I'm including is accurate and can give you a general impression. One of the mainstays of aplastic anemia treatment is bone marrow transplantation. That's not always possible for a variety of reasons. For patients who can't be transplanted, immunosuppressive therapies are typically used. And then there are various growth factors, androgen hormones that can be used to help support the blood counts as well. And fortunately, all of these are very effective treatments. So what about the outcome? So the natural history, meaning what happens if you don't treat aplastic anemia? Without treatment, this really varies depending on the degree of severity. So moderate disease can do quite well, and many patients will go on to even have just a spontaneous recovery if those counts are relatively, they're decreased, but just sort of mildly decreased. Patients who meet criteria for severe aplastic anemia absolutely need treatment, because without therapy, this is a very aggressive disease that can be fatal sometimes in a matter of days, but certainly within months. So this really is a hematologic emergency. It does need to be treated. Fortunately, like I say, we have very effective treatments, and five-year survival data is typically quoted at about 80% now. And so that's much improved compared to previous years. There are long-term complications we need to be on the lookout for. So close clinical follow-up is important. There's a proportion of patients who will relapse, even after successful treatment. And then long-term survivors are at risk for development of other conditions. So some patients can develop paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, or PNH, that we'll talk about in a second. And then there is an increased risk of developing myeloid cancers, including acute myeloid leukemia or myelodysplastic syndromes. And so these patients are followed very carefully so that we can keep an eye out for that. Okay, so that's aplastic anemia. Now we're going to talk about another very interesting condition here, paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, or PNH. And this is a disease that was first described way back in the 1800s. By the man on the right here. This is a famous English physician named William Gull. And he wrote a paper describing a patient who was found to have dark urine that was present only in the morning. And there's an example of what this looks like, where because of blood in the urine, it turns very dark, and the urine tends to be most concentrated in the morning. So that's when it becomes most obvious. So PNH, we now understand, is another acquired and clonal disease. We'll talk about what that means. Biologically, this is due to an abnormality in a glycolipid anchor protein that's called GPI. And I always have trouble pronouncing this one, glycophosphatidyl inositol. So we'll just call it GPI. And this GPI is a chemical that's required to localize many different proteins to the cell surface. And I'll show you an example of that. So PNH typically presents around age 40 on average. Men and women are affected. This is a rare diagnosis, 2 to 5 times less common than aplastic anemia. Patients typically present because of the anemia. This is what we call an intravascular hemolytic anemia. On the peripheral blood smear, the red cells basically look normal. The reticulocytes can be increased or decreased. There's other laboratory results we use to help us with this diagnosis where we tend to see decreased haptoglobin levels in the blood, and then we see the presence of hemoglobin in the urine. About 20% of cases in the U.S. Will develop major blood clots at presentation, and these tend to be blood clots affecting large veins. Veins in the liver, that's a Budd-Chiari syndrome, cerebral vein or other abdominal veins. And then there's other patients who basically have a clinical picture that looks like what we see in aplastic anemia. So there's this very interesting relationship between these two diagnoses. So about a third of patients who are diagnosed with PNH have previously been diagnosed as aplastic anemia. About another third of patients will eventually go on to be diagnosed with aplastic anemia. And the remaining third really just have anemia without developing an aplastic anemia. So we now know that PNH is due to the development of mutations in a gene called PIGA. And this PIGA is an enzyme that's required for synthesizing this GPI anchor. There are many different mutations that have been described, and they all lead to the same effect. They lead to absence of these GPI anchored proteins on our cell surfaces. So if you look at normal bone marrows, it turns out all of us have a very small percentage of our cells that have mutations in this gene. But in PNH, there's, for some reason, there's been an expansion of this mutated clone. So it's become a much bigger proportion of cells in the peripheral blood and bone marrow. So here's little diagram of what this GPI anchor looks like. Down here on the left, we have this purple is showing you the lipid bilayer, that's the cell membrane. And the red circles up here are showing you the end of a protein. And then in between is this GPI chemical, and it's attached at the protein to one end, and at the other end it sticks into the cell membrane. And then here's the chemical structure. There's this one chemical bond here that is catalyzed by this PIGA protein. And so if that's not there, that bond can't form. And this cell, this protein can't be attached to the cell the way it's supposed to be. So there are many different proteins that use these GPI anchors. Many of these proteins may be responsible for some of the symptoms that we see in PNH. But we think two of the most important are these shown here, a protein called CD55 and one called CD59. These are regulators of complement. The complement system is part of our immune system, and it is a process that basically kills and lyses cells that can be infected with microorganisms or have other abnormalities. And the CD55 and CD59 proteins normally serve to turn off complement at the end of a reaction. And so what happens is that in PNH, without CD55 and CD59 present, you get sort of runaway activation of the complement system, and it starts lysing cells that it really shouldn't be. And so this includes lysis of red blood cells that leads to anemia. When complement interacts with platelets, instead of lysing the platelets, it actually activates the platelets. And so that leads to increased clotting. There's probably other abnormalities as well. We know if you take PNH type cells out of the bone marrow, they don't grow in the laboratory the way they should. So it's probably more than just CD55 and CD59, but it seems to be a big part of it. The diagnosis of PNH has changed a lot over the years. This, of course, in the 19th century was purely a diagnosis made on clinical grounds, seeing the changes in the urine and physical examination. The first laboratory test came along in the 1930s with development of what was called a Ham's test. That's basically become outdated today and isn't used anymore. Beginning in the 1990s, we had development of a technique called flow cytometry, and that's really become the standard way we make this diagnosis today. We do this in our laboratory. We look for loss of these GPI anchored proteins on the cell surface. There are published guidelines, very detailed, about the best way to do this type of testing. We look for these GPI anchored proteins on multiple cell types, including red cells and white cells. And we can use this method to monitor patients with PNH who are being treated. We'll go through this. We will go through this very quickly, but just in case you're interested, this is what the test actually looks like. This is what we review. Where each of the dots we're looking at here is a different cell that's going through the analyzer. We go through some complicated maneuvers to specifically look only at the white blood cells in this particular example, but we also look at red cells. And if we look down here in the lower left, here we're looking for using two different markers, looking for cells expressing these GPI anchored proteins. So these are normal cells up here on the top that are expressing these proteins in the upper right. And then down here in the lower left, these are abnormal cells that are missing these GPI anchored proteins. And you can see it's a very small fraction, 0.08% of the cells. But this would be considered an abnormal result that is consistent with a diagnosis of PNH. Bone marrow biopsy is not done all that often in these patients. It can be done at initial diagnosis. When we see these, PNH can be a real challenge for us in the pathology laboratory because what we see under the microscope can be quite variable. We can have, in some cases, you have actually increased cellularity. Other cases, it looks very empty, just like an aplastic anemia. In some cases, we can see some changes, some of these dysplastic or dyspoetic changes that creates a differential diagnosis with myelodysplastic syndromes. Cytogenetics are typically normal, but every once in a while, we'll see abnormal cases as well. And again, those can be some of the harder cases to differentiate from myelodysplastic syndromes. In terms of treatment, this again is quite complex. Immunosuppressives have been used and that can improve the blood counts. Trying to manage the risk of blood clots is very important. That's a major source of problems for these patients. Within the last several years, the treatment has really changed pretty dramatically with development of a drug called eculizumab. This is a monoclonal antibody that inhibits the C5 complement protein. And so this can effectively stop that sort of runaway complement activity that we see in PNH. Bone marrow transplantation is sometimes considered, just as it is for many of the bone marrow failure syndromes, but usually this is done only in severe cases that are not responding to other types of therapies, but sometimes it is a recommended course also. The outcomes in PNH continue to get better all the time. So if you're looking through the literature and you look at older papers, even things that were being published up until about the year 2000 or so, they would often quote a 10-year survival rate of about 50%. If you look at more recent studies, you'll typically see things like 70% or greater quoted. But with some of these newer drugs available, the experts in this disease are really quite excited that, we think we're nearing a point where many patients can actually approach a normal life expectancy, for age, because of all the advances in treatment in recent years. So there's been a lot of very exciting work done in this area. With all of the bone marrow failure disorders, there can be a risk of transformation to an acute leukemia down the line. But in PNH, this seems to be a very low risk. If it happens at all, is only in a very small percentage of patients. Okay, so those were two of the more common pancytopenia syndromes. Now we're going to go and talk about some disorders that affect just one cell type. And we'll go through these much more quickly. Beginning with pure red cell aplasia. So this is rare. There's really only a few hundred cases reported in the literature. It seems to be more common in women, median age of onset around age 60. And this is defined as basically anemia. That's due to absence of red blood cell precursors in the bone marrow. So the white blood cells are normal, the platelets are normal. There's none of these dysplastic changes or dysboetic changes under the microscope. So the cells that are there look normal, and cytogenetic studies are normal. There are a couple other processes that we think about in the differential diagnosis of pure red cell aplasia. There are a couple self-limited processes, so temporary processes. First is what's often called a transient aplastic crisis. This is due to infection with a virus called parvovirus B19. Parvo B19 is a pretty common virus of childhood. It causes so-called Fifth's disease of childhood. In most kids, this actually shows up and it looks like a cold or the flu or something, and kids get over it very quickly and no one pays too much attention to it. But in some patients, especially those who have severe immunodeficiencies or immunosuppression, classically this is seen in HIV/AIDS when you are infected with parvovirus B19, you can get infection of the red blood cells that basically leads to a red cell aplasia. As that viral infection resolves, though, this clears up over a course of weeks, and the anemia goes away. There's also another process that's called transient erythroblastopenia of childhood. This is really quite rare. This basically looks a lot like a parvovirus B19 infection, where again, you get a very abrupt anemia. The red cells in the bone marrow are wiped out, and then they all come back a few weeks later. This is also thought to be likely some other viral infection, but a specific virus has never been identified. So the cause of this is not clear. But again, it can usually be recognized on the basis of the age and the clinical course. Now there's also a hereditary pure red cell aplasia called diamond black fan anemia. And we can sometimes think about that as well, but typically diamond black fan anemia presents in young children pure red cell aplasia is mostly going to happen in the middle-aged to elderly population, so there's not much overlap there. And pure red cell aplasia, we think in most cases, is an autoimmune disease. It can be a humoral response, meaning that we find antibodies in the blood that are directed against red cells. We can also see T cells that are attacking the red cells. We can look carefully for a variety of different conditions that can trigger development of pure red cell aplasia. There's a lot of different things shown here. These can include other tumors. One of the classic phenomenons are thymomas. These are benign tumors of the thymus that can be associated with pure red cell aplasia. But we can see this with other autoimmune disorders, viral infections, and drug reactions. In terms of treatment, patients are typically transfused, given immunosuppression. If we can find one of those underlying triggers, then we want to treat that. For example, in those thymomas, those are typically treated by surgical resection. And if you remove the thymoma, the red cell aplasia goes away. The prognosis here is really very good. More than 80% of these patients will respond to therapy. Some will even resolve spontaneously sometimes. And there seems to be a very low risk of transformation to an acute leukemia. Agranulocytosis, this is a similar phenomenon now affecting white cells, right? So in the peripheral blood, you have no white blood cells, and in the bone marrow, you don't have white blood cell precursors. Agranulocytosis is almost always a drug reaction. There are some drugs that seem to cause direct damage to the white blood cells, but most of them seem to trigger an autoimmune type of phenomenon where the immune system then cross-reacts against the white blood cells. We can look for anti-neutrophil antibodies in the laboratory, and they're often present, but this is really not a specific finding. Anti-neutrophil antibodies are found in a lot of different conditions, not just in agranulocytosis. And they're not always present. Sometimes this is more of a T cell response rather than an antibody response. There are a very small number of patients where there don't seem to have been any prior drug exposures that we can tie this to. In those cases, we think it's a purely spontaneous autoimmune process called pure white cell aplasia. In terms of outcome, again, this is one that needs to be treated because untreated, a severe agranulocytosis, these patients get recurrent infections with a very high mortality rate. Fortunately, this is relatively simple to treat in that you want to find the drug that was associated with it, stop that drug, and give growth factors that are going to improve the white blood cell count. And then the final example of these unilineage disorders is called amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenic purpura, which basically translates into low platelets because you're not making platelets in the bone marrow. And so that's just what you see. In the peripheral blood smear, we have very few platelets that are present. And when we do a bone marrow biopsy, we don't see megakaryocytes. This is extremely rare. It's the least common of all the things that we're talking about today. It is not very well characterized, but is thought to be either an autoimmune or a drug reaction, and it's typically been treated with immunosuppressive therapies. Okay, so now we'll talk about just one last entity, and this is Fanconi anemia. So we'll talk about this as an example of an inherited bone marrow failure syndrome. So this disorder was first described back in 1927 by this doctor shown here. This is Guido Fanconi, who was a Swiss pediatrician. And he published a paper describing three brothers who unfortunately had all died with a fatal aplastic anemia, and they had multiple congenital abnormalities. So in addition to the aplastic anemia and the low blood counts, they also had hyperpigmentation of the skin. They had skeletal defects, small stature, and hypogonadism. Now, over the years, we've learned a lot about Fanconi's anemia, and it's now become clear that there are many, many different types of congenital findings that you can see in these families. And that's illustrated in this table. We don't need to go through these in detail, but just realize that almost any organ system can have associated abnormality at birth in Fanconi's. One thing I would point out in this table is this very bottom line here, where it says no abnormalities, 30%. So all patients with Fanconi's have an aplastic anemia type picture with pancytopenia and a hypocellular bone marrow. But 30% of these patients don't have any other findings. So the development is otherwise normal. And so that means when these patients are first being seen in the clinic without these other associated congenital findings, their doctors may not at first be thinking about hereditary symptoms, hereditary diseases. And so distinguishing this from aplastic anemia can really be challenging. So what do we see in these patients? Well, basically all of them will develop blood abnormalities. At the time of birth, usually the blood counts are normal, or there might just be macrocytosis, so enlarged red cells. But low counts will develop in essentially all patients, usually around ages 5 to 10. But some families, this seems to be quite late. It can happen in adulthood. And the latest age I could find in the literature was a patient who was first diagnosed at age 56. So we have to think about this diagnosis sometimes in adults too. Unfortunately, one of the major difficulties in these families is that there is a markedly increased risk of cancers. And these are especially blood cancers. So by age 40, a full 52% of these patients have developed a myelodysplastic syndrome or an acute myeloid leukemia. So that's an enormous increase in the risk over the general population. There's also an increased risk for other types of tumors as well, head and neck squamous cell carcinomas, and liver tumors. In terms of bone marrow findings, we again see a very hypocellular looking bone marrow. This tends to look very much like an aplastic anemia, just an empty bone marrow. Sometimes we can see under the microscope evidence of abnormal maturation, this dysplastic changes or dysplasias. Cytogenetic studies are usually normal, but sometimes we can see these transient abnormalities, just like with aplastic anemia. And then some of these patients actually won't come to medical attention until they've already developed a myelodysplastic syndrome or acute myeloid leukemia. And then the challenge is really to recognize the underlying Fanconi's anemia that has led to development of that disease. So how do we actually recognize these? Well, Fanconi's is basically defined by sensitivity of the chromosomes to chemicals that damage DNA. And so we do this in the laboratory by taking cells, growing them in culture, and we expose them to chemicals that damage DNA. These are two of the chemicals used most often. And this is what this looks like under the microscope. This is a cell that has been lysed open, and the cell's chromosomes have spilled out on the slide here. And so some of these chromosomes look normal, like this one here. But every place you see one of these arrows, it's pointing to a chromosome that has an abnormal break. And so someone actually sits and looks at the chromosomes in these and actually counts up how many chromosome breaks you have. There is a range that's considered normal. And if you're outside of that normal range, that's an abnormal result that's consistent with Fanconi. We now understand a lot more about the genetics of this disease as well. And it turns out that there's a big range in terms of the inherited mutations that give rise to Fanconi anemia. Mutations in more than 21 genes have now been described in different families. These are almost always inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion. And so here's a table of all the genes that have been identified as of a couple of years ago. Again, this is very busy. We don't need to look at these. This is just to show how complex the genetics of this is. This has, studying these genes has helped us really understand some underlying biology here. It turns out all of these genes actually function in one biologic pathway. There is one complex of proteins that is responsible for repairing DNA damage, and that's shown down here. And so this is sometimes called the Fanconi anemia complex, or the BRCA1, BRCA2 complex. This is the complex that directly repairs DNA damage. And then upstream in this pathway are different proteins that regulate that repair. And so each of these different circles is a different protein, and all the ones colored in green have been shown to be mutated in some patients with Fanconi anemia. So abnormalities in any of these proteins in this pathway can all lead to the same process. And I think this, all of the differences between these different proteins probably explains some of the differences we see between different families with Fanconis. The prognosis in Fanconi anemia continues to improve pretty dramatically. This is a graph from the Fanconi Anemia Foundation website. If you go back to the late 80s and early 90s, when I was going into medical school, unfortunately, many of these patients died in early childhood. But in recent decades, that life expectancy continues to get better and better as we get better at managing this condition. Bone marrow transplant is an important part of this that can be curative for the blood abnormalities. But unfortunately, these patients do still have an increased cancer risk of other types of cancer, not just blood cancers. And so that continues to be a challenge. But again, survival continues to improve for this disease. Okay, that's where we'll end for the day. Hopefully, I've tried to give you sort of an overview of the biology of these diseases. These are obviously very complex and are very challenging for all of us to work with, patients, families, and doctors alike. The diagnosis of these is complex, and it really requires a team-based approach, including experts in clinical hematology, hematopathologists who are experts in bone marrow pathology, and medical geneticists. Our ability to diagnose and classify these disorders is getting better all the time. Our understanding of the genetics of these diseases is growing very quickly. This is really helping us to understand something about the normal development of blood cells in the bone marrow and giving new insights into ways to treat these conditions. And we're seeing outcomes to continue to improve because of these advances. With that, I will stop, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cook. We have a few questions that have come in. Our first question is, how often should an MDS patient have a bone marrow biopsy, and under what circumstances may they have one beyond their initial diagnosis?
Okay, sure. Yeah, that's a very good question. So follow-up bone marrow biopsies is an important way to monitor the progress of what's going on in all of these disorders, including the myelodysplastic syndromes. Exactly how often that should be is really going to vary depending on exactly the diagnosis and some of the details about your condition. But I'll say that we may see some patients where a biopsy is done every 3 months. More often, it's more like every 6 months to a year. But again, there's a lot of different situations that might make your treating doctor want to look more often. The other thing to consider is that there are a large number of clinical trials that are out there for many of these. We always encourage everyone to talk to their doctors about clinical trials that are available. And if you're being treated on a clinical trial, those very often have sort of a hardwired schedule for how often the bone marrow biopsies are performed.
Thank you so much. Can MDS be diagnosed without a bone marrow biopsy?
Right, that's another very good question. With working from the peripheral blood alone, we can recognize that there is some type of myeloid neoplasm present. But the myelodysplastic syndromes, the diagnosis and the criteria we use, remember there's about, somewhere, I haven't counted these up in a while, but probably 12 to 15 different subtypes. And to distinguish between all of these different subtypes and really get to the most accurate diagnosis, that requires seeing a bone marrow specimen. So the technical answer is a bone marrow biopsy is required. Now, there might be some situations where we know we're in sort of that family of myelodysplastic syndromes, and it might not exactly alter the treatment. And so that's something to talk to your treating doctor about. In my condition, with the options that are available for me and given my general state of health, would it make enough of a difference that we need to do a bone marrow biopsy, or could we just avoid doing that? But in general, this is going to require a bone marrow biopsy.
Thank you very much. What tests are done to measure the number of blasts in the bone marrow?
Okay, sure. Yep, that's another good question. So we do this a couple different ways. What's really considered the gold standard, believe it or not, it sounds very old-fashioned, but the gold standard for counting blasts is actually a pathologist like me looking at a bone marrow slide and actually counting them. So it's actually a human being sitting and counting usually 500 cells and saying how many out of those 500 are blasts. But there are other tests we can use to help us with those. So flow cytometry is often done, which can help us look for blasts where we look for, usually CD34 is a marker on cells that we use to help us count blasts. And then we can do what we call immunostains on the bone marrow biopsies as well to help us count also. It's really in large part still that manual count which is, you know, kind of funny because that's been sort of the gold standard since the 1800s. But it's still something we do every day and is sort of the most important of them.
Thank you. Our next question is there a test to determine the count of healthy versus cancerous bone marrow stem cells?
Yeah, thanks. That's a very good question. So we can try to sort that out sometimes by flow cytometry. So where if we do flow cytometry, we tend to look at expression of a bunch of different proteins on the cell surface. And in some cases, there's an abnormal pattern of those proteins that we can say, yes, this subset seems to be the abnormal precursor cells in the bone marrow, and this subset seems to be normal. But that's not true in every case. There are cases of MDS where that pattern of protein expression that we see is basically normal. So sometimes we can sort that out, but not always.
Thank you. How often is MDS diagnosed where it is predominantly the platelet count that is affected, but the red and white cells are close to being normal?
Ah, sure, that's another good one. For myelodysplastic syndromes in general, the cell line that tends to be affected the most are the red cells. So the great majority of cases of myelodysplastic syndromes will have anemia, so low red cell counts. And having only platelets below with normal red cells is unusual in MDS, but it does sometimes happen. That's a situation where, I think a bone marrow biopsy is definitely going to be needed to sort out that diagnosis. So I would say it's probably less than 10% of MDS cases, but it definitely happens.
Thank you. Besides having a bone marrow biopsy, what other tests should be done when you're trying to determine a bone marrow failure?
Oh, sure. There's a number of different tests that are routinely done. And it kind of varies depending exactly on the clinical situation. But the workups typically start with just doing normal blood counts, so complete blood counts with differentials. Often clinicians will look at the levels of different growth factors, like erythropoietin, which is a hormone that regulates red blood cell production. Often they may look at an enzyme called LDH, lactose dehydrogenase. And then there's, depending on the situation, there may be other blood tests as well. So flow cytometry for these PNH type cells, as we mentioned, can be done in some settings. But it's really the bone marrow biopsy together with the cytogenetic studies on the bone marrow and flow cytometry that are some of the most important.
Thank you. Which tests are most helpful in diagnosing aplastic anemia, MDS, or PNH?
Yeah, sure. So I think for all of these, looking at what we see in a standard bone marrow biopsy is kind of the starting point. The flow cytometry for PNH type cells is very helpful. And then when aplastic anemia is in the consideration, then we often end up doing tests looking for various viral infections. And we mentioned, that long list of things that can cause secondary aplastic anemias. And so there can be sometimes quite extensive blood tests that need to be done to look for all of those different infection possibilities as well.
Thank you. And we have time for one last question. Can IG therapy affect labs for diagnosis?
Immunoglobulin therapies can be used as an immunosuppressive drug, and that can improve counts. As a general rule, if we have the choice as pathologists, we always prefer to see a biopsy sample before treatment has been started. But with that said, I think IG treatment shouldn't change very much of what we're seeing under the microscope. It can improve the counts in the peripheral blood. So it may not look as severe then by the time we're looking at the bone marrow biopsy, but usually, we have access to all of the historical records so we can know what your counts looked like before you were treated as well. So I'd say in general, it wouldn't have a major impact, but in general, we always like to see a biopsy before treatment is started, if that's possible. It's not always possible.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Cook, for sharing your time and your expertise with all of us today. If anyone would like to watch this webinar again at a later time, it will be available on our website within 2 to 3 business days. If we were not able to get to your question today, please feel free to send it to us at any time in 3 ways. Please email help@aamds.org. Please call our helpline at 800-747-2820, extension 2, or submit a question on our Facebook page. On behalf of the Aplastic Anemia and MDS International Foundation, thank you for joining us today, making us your resource of choice for information on bone marrow failure diseases. The Aplastic Anemia and MDS International Foundation Medical Advisory Board and team are here to serve you and your family as we have done for the past 37 years. This concludes our program. Thank you, Dr. Cook.
Thank you.